Welcome or welcome back. It's Becky, and today we're modifying a Kit Kat clock to make the eyes follow you around the room. It's my project for this year's Maker Secret Santa, which I'll be making for my friend Zyla Foxlin. Keep watching to learn how to build this DIY electronics project and what I got from my Santa. So I have to admit, I had this idea last year and I thought it would be a great fit for anybody but Tony. But then I got Tony, who rarely shows his face, so making a face tracking gift didn't seem appropriate. But it's perfect for Zyla, who loves cats but is allergic. She visited my studio recently and I tried to play it cool, but I think she became suspicious. At least she had no idea what the actual gift was, even if she suspected that I was her Santa. Zyla is a multi-talented maker, engineer, and fellow YouTuber, so be sure to check out her channel and hit subscribe. We recently did a collab together where we built a DIY version of her old startup product, a plushie that sends hugs over the internet.
Zyla, tell me how you feel about cats.
Cats? I think they're so cute, but they also are trying to kill me at all times.
Meet the Kit Kat clock. It's full of vintage American charm, usefully tells time, and it's hypoallergenic.
Kit Kat is an American classic dating back to the Great Depression of the 1930s. The happy smile, swishing tail, and animated eyes brightened any room during tough times way back then, and our replica Kit Kat clock still brings a smile to everyone's face whenever they see him. Who can resist Kit Kat? I'm really gonna miss you picking fights and me falling for it, screaming
that I'm right. The idea is simple. Make the cat's eyes follow you. The clock's eyes and tail movements are controlled by a long lever arm. So I needed to insert my own control over this lever arm. I used a servo motor, hot glue, and zip ties to affix the lever arm to the servo and the servo to the clock. Then carefully severed the connection between the part of the lever arm connected to the eyes and the part connected to the tail. More about the tail later. I first tried out the DF Robot Husky Lens vision board for this project, which is super easy to use and has a built-in screen. But because I wanted to get the camera into the nose of the Kit Kat clock, and there's no need for a screen nor a lot of room for one in this project, I opted to use the Seed Grove AI vision board instead, along with a Zhao RP2040 board. Regardless of the vision board, a camera with a longer cable is required to feed into the tight space that is the cat's nose. The DF Robot and Seed vision boards use the same camera as each other, and I found replacements with longer cables available on Amazon. I bought the wide-angle version and tried that out first, but I ended up switching back to the normal viewing angle camera after trying it out. I'll show you why in a minute. To fit the camera in the nose, I used a center punch to make a divot in the center of the nose, then a small drill bit to make a pilot hole. I only have one clock, so this helps avoid the risk of cracking it. Then I used a step drill on my drill press to make the appropriate size hole and hot glued it in place from the inside, being careful not to get any glue on the eyes. This was the trickiest part of this project, really. I ended up using some painter's tape to help hold it in place from the front, some tweezers to help hold it in place from the back, and some canned air to rapidly cool the hot glue. This vision board is designed to work with the Zhao board footprint, so my little RP2040 board fits right in. Then I went and added some wires for the servo motor, and this is where I accidentally lost one of the passive components during soldering, and after a clumsy attempt to reattach it, I decided to stop and test that it still worked before I made it even worse. What's one capacitor, right? First, I loaded up a test sketch to control the motor, and that worked just fine. I adjusted the servo positions to match the observable range of the eyes without overextending to one side or the other. Next, I fired up the object recognition Grove AI vision example for Arduino, and it successfully connected to the camera module, so I guess that capacitor wasn't so important after all. Then I added the one line of code I had to write for this project, setting the motor position relative to the X position of the detected object. It worked a little too well. The eyes darted to their new position way too fast. So I wrote a few more lines of code to have the servo move in timed increments to its new position, so it animates there at a controlled speed. To see what the camera sees, you can plug in an additional USB cable to the Vision module and load up this special site that communicates with it over serial. I noticed that my wide-angle lens was capturing windows and lights and impeded its ability to detect people. I adjusted the camera angle, but was still not working as well as I'd like, so I decided to switch back to the regular viewing angle camera. The wide-angle one would be great for projects that are close up to your head, not projects that need to see you from across the room. One thing I learned after fiddling with the camera repeatedly is that the white paint on the front of the clock is alcohol soluble. I use alcohol to release the hot glue bond for replacing and repositioning the camera, but after I figured out why there was white paint on me all of a sudden, I was a little more careful with my application. After I was happy with the camera position, I glued it permanently using some UV nail polish. The object detection still gets distracted by big windows, so I had to try a few different mounting locations before I found one that tracked me consistently. But it works. It's just the right combo of creepy and cute. And it doesn't connect to the internet, so it's safer to put up in your home than any security camera, basically. I thought I could let the tail animate as it was originally intended, which is driven by an electromagnet inside the clock base. But once I disconnected the top half, the bottom half isn't as balanced anymore, so the swinging tail swings further and hits the sides of the body. I taped the tail post in place so the tail doesn't do anything now, and Xyla can untape it if she wants the tail to wag later. I packed up the modified KitKat clock in its original box and included a long USB cable and an AC adapter for plugging it in. I left the clock circuit, powered by two batteries, alone so it can function separately if desired. I included some video instructions since it doesn't boot right up. Maybe that capacitor I lost is to blame, but the reset button has to be pressed after the board already has power for the Vision module to boot up. I hope she likes it. Something I could do if I had more time is to train the object recognition to just Xyla's face, but this way her friends can get in on the fun too. Anyway, go and see her open it on her channel right after I show you what I got in the mail this year.
What it is. Sounds and smells like it could be handmade. It's heavy. Oh my gosh. Does it ever end? Well, it says a parallel universe clamps. I already know that this must be from Tony. It has to be, right? Who else would make a joke like that? Yep, it's from Tony. That's great. We meet again. How the tables have turned. Happy YouTube Secret Santa. Yay, Tony. Okay, I'll read the note. Love it. Okay. The parallel universe clamps. Oh, wow. Oh my gosh. Look at that. They're machined parallel clamps with my name engraved in them, and they look like they're made out of steel and brass. Wow, these are so nice.
From what I've learned, these are machinist clamps, also called toolmaker's clamps. I can imagine using them on my jewelry bench or tiny drill press to hold something steady. They're nice and heavy and can be tightened down with a little piece of metal. I'm using a small Allen wrench to achieve a really tight grip. And knowing Tony, he probably did all of the machining of these parts himself. I can't wait to watch the clip of the texture on the knob here or the engraving of my name. Thanks again, Tony. I will cherish these clamps forever. Make sure you go over to Tony's channel to see how he made these and check out the other Secret Santa videos in the circle. That's it for this year. I hope you'll subscribe with the bell to be notified of my future uploads, subscribe to my email newsletter, and find me on your favorite social platforms. This year, I'm making the final push to 100,000 YouTube subscribers, and it would mean a lot to me if you helped me reach that goal. This video doesn't have an outside sponsor. Instead, I'd like to highlight all the other ways I pay the bills around here. First up is no surprise, it's Patreon and YouTube memberships. If you're able to directly support me in this way, amazing. Thank you so much. There are a few other ways that don't cost you any extra. One is to shop using my affiliate links. I get a commission on whatever you buy, even if it's not the thing you originally clicked on. And the best and most free way to support me is to share my stuff with somebody who will enjoy it. I promise my channel's got something for everyone. If it's not this video, then check out my back catalog and share something you like better. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.